Okay, so we can get started. Let me share my screen. You know, what we will do is we will have a very quick overcap of the entire knowledge area that we did, and then we start deep diving into Agile. हाँ जी, तो we did quite a lot of discussion, so we will just do a recap. So make sure that all of us are in sync. So if you see, you know, there are six areas that we understood, so if you see BABOK, there are a lot of knowledge areas that they have explained, but the only problem, as we know with BABOK, they have not explained those knowledge areas in the right order. So if you see, whenever you work on any project or a program, right, always do a little bit of strategy analysis. This is very, very important. Even if you're not supposed to do it, or you're not expected to do it, you know, there is something that you should do always is strategy analysis. And I always, whenever I, you know, manage a team, we have a lot of product managers in our team. They work on, basically, there's a complete digital transformation practice that we have set up. And all those product managers, they work on various assignments. So when they work on various assignments, what we have seen is by the time work reaches them, you know, strategy analysis is already over. And all they're expected is to get involved in execution phase. So they're not even involved in planning phase. So they are just told that this is the change that we are working on. You have to gather requirements and get it developed with help of a Scrum team, if it's Agile. If it's a waterfall, then typical software development team. So I always advise my team that whenever you are working on any assignment, even if they do not expect you, try to understand the context of that problem or the opportunity. So always, you know, talk to your business. And if they have done strategy analysis, ask them to, you know, give you the access to whatever analysis they have done. So this is very, very important, because in strategy analysis, you understand the current state, which is nothing but you understand the current problem or the opportunity. And, you know, what is the root cause of that problem? You really understand that. And you understand, as I said, you know, the current offering, the current product, services, the procedures. So you understand all of that. So current state is very, very important, because if you do not understand current state, you will never be able to negotiate requirements, as simple as that. So you will be simply an order taker. So whosoever will tell you do this, you will do that. And then you cannot do justice to your job. So current state is very important. After current state, you definitely develop the future state, which is your PRD. So even if you're working on a small piece, And this is the challenge most of my team members face, that, you know, they do not have the visibility of the entire program or the project, and they're involved in the small piece. Now, if you understand the current state and, you know, and you understand the problem at a original scale, so whatever piece of requirement you are writing, you know, BRD, whatever small problem has been assigned to you and you are writing the BRD, you can make sure that this BRD is complete. And the most important thing is you can do something called impact analysis really well. So that is very, very important. And also, whatever value that you have, potential value that you are trying to establish through your, you know, change that you are conceptualizing, you will make sure that this potential value matches with the overall vision of the program. Okay. This is also very matches with overall vision. And then you, after the future state is done, the current state is done, you basically, you know, do something called solution. So solution again is very, very important. You work with architect, you figure out the various options, you do the pros and cons analysis of each option, right? So that is also very important. Then you recommend the solution option, you know, which can help you attain the maximum potential value that you're trying to achieve, okay? That's the reason you establish potential value. So if potential value is you want to reduce cost or increase customer experience, for example, Amazon, you know, one of my friends is working in Amazon. So I was asking them that what is the value they always trying to achieve in any of the, you know, app development. So Amazon, they do not even consider cost as an issue. You know, so their mindset is cost is not an issue. The potential value is customer experience, enhanced customer experience, as simple as that. So all the engagements, he's working in Amazon Pay. So I was asking him, you know, what are the future features they are working in Amazon Pay? They're doing incredible amount of stuff when it comes to Amazon Pay. And you will see all of that in the next 4 or 5 years. So all of that they're doing, they don't even look at cost. They don't even look at profit. Right? All they look at is enhancing customer experience. So you need to have that understanding of potential value. And accordingly, you recommend the solution. Then you do the risk assessment for sure. So now risk assessment you do is that whatever risk, you know, risk are probable events. If they happen, they will affect your chances to realize the potential value. As simple as that. So all those risks that you think, you know, are applicable to the solution that you are developing, you estimate that, you develop your strategy, right? Like either you mitigate, you accept the risk, you avoid the risk, you transfer the risk. And finally, you do something called a business case. So you will be amazed, like in business case of Amazon, they do mention the cost and expected profit because that is part and parcel of business case. But the business case doesn't get rejected because cost is high or the profit is less. The business case will be rejected if impact on customer experience is not much. So you have to enhance the customer experience. So that is what we call as strategy analysis. Okay. Any question, please, on strategy analysis? So after strategy analysis, we do, you know, BA planning and monitoring, which is again very important. Yeah, somebody saying something? Okay, somebody, I think, joined. Okay, no worries. So in BA planning monitoring, you plan for BA approach. You decide whether it's agile, waterfall. We'll talk about agile today. You plan for, you know, stakeholders. I told you how, you know, if you ask me, all this is meaningless. Trust me, if you do not manage a stakeholder, you know, you do the excellent current state analysis, future state has zero value. So have that mindset, you know, start, you know, figuring out who all are critical stakeholders that you work with. You know, what is their influence level? What is their impact level? And accordingly, develop strategies to collaborate with your stakeholders. Okay. And have that value, you know, something called 360 degree feedback. This is very, very important. When we work, you know, if you ask me what is your, you know, mantra for stakeholder collaboration is, I always tend to be very, very intellectually humble. So that is very, very important. I mean, never carry any baggage that you have 15 years of experience, 16, 17, you know that, you train people. You know, when you work with stakeholders, definitely all of that help. It adds to your confidence. But there is much more than knowledge, right? It is all about the trust you develop and the confidence that you build. That is what helps you, you know, get things done. So stakeholder management collaboration is very, very important, especially as you grow up. It's all about stakeholder management and, you know, the kind of influence, the kind of dynamics they have. If you ask me, my 50% of my job, you know, is involved around stakeholder management. So that is how it is important. Then, you know, you even define how you manage change in requirements, governance approach. How will you, what kind of requirements you will create, information management approach. You do something called, you know, and then you prepare even the metrics by which you will be evaluated as a PA, right? So you do all that planning and monitoring and giving. And that's the reason the monitoring keyword came, because the metrics are there. So you even monitor your metrics of performance. You help PM to monitor the performance metric. So after PM, sorry, somebody saying something. Yeah. So after PM, you actually start doing the real work. And that's the reason you say that you start the elicitation in formal manner. But please do remember that elicitation is always there, right? As soon as you are talking to someone or you're reading a document or you're doing a research, you're doing elicitation, right? But in the formal manner, because planning is done, now you will start gathering requirements to do elicitation. So elicitation is a very simple knowledge area. You prepare for elicitation. Basically, you decide, you know, which are the, you know, technique that you will use. That is very important. So elicitation is all about getting your technique right. So if you are talking to a very senior stakeholder, I generally do not involve them in requirement workshop, very senior stakeholder. Because in workshop, you discuss a lot of things which you may not even require to discuss. You know, you try to understand the overall landscape and you do a little bit of, you know, research during the workshop. So now senior stakeholder, you have to value their time. Generally, when I involve senior stakeholder, I generally have a questionnaire ready and I do something called interview, as simple as that. So I involve them, I ask those basic questions and, you know, generally I try to wrap up everything within a 30 minute. So this is how you prepare for elicitation. You know, conduct the elicitation, you get the raw notes, you confirm elicitation results, right? And definitely you have to do something called collaboration with the stakeholders. So that collaboration with the stakeholder became so important that there's actually a task in elicitation knowledge area. and also you communicate your BA information. Okay, so what BA box says is that do not only restrict yourself to requirements. If you, you know, if you see a resource is going on leave, basically what BA box is saying is trying to have that ownership mindset. So if you see that even developers are having some issue, if testers are having some issue, if, you know, all of that, you know, whatever issues they are facing, don't think it's a Scrum Master job or a project manager job. Be a partner for project manager. And I tell you one thing, in today's world, we do not hire project managers. We do not hire BAs. We hire product managers. So the product manager, the guy whom we are hiring, he's responsible not only for business analysis, he's also responsible for project management. So that is the trend going on. So we don't have project managers, we don't have BAs, we have product managers, and they are the one, you know, who not only do this BA walk, which I have explained to you, they are actually responsible for doing PM walk, a project manager body, management body of knowledge. So they do that as well, right? So they, you know, they are responsible for awarding scope creep, scope management. They do cost management, right? They do time management. So they do all of that, resource management, stakeholder management. They're responsible for the quality of the product. So quality management, if a vendor is involved, they're responsible for procurement. So as a product manager right now, you know, I'm actually spending time with finance, understanding the contract, you know, financial terms in contract that we are signing. Spending time with legal in understanding the legal contract. So all of that job was used to be done by a project manager. Now, being a product owner, you are a one point of contact. So anything related to management, be it requirement management or a project management, you are responsible. So this is what BA Box is trying to explain to everybody in, you know, in this entire knowledge area. So after elicitation, you do requirement analysis and design definition. We talked about that we, you know, we specify and model requirements, right? So whatever requirements you have, you do the verification, standard quality check, you do validation, right? Which is the functional accuracy check. You create a requirement architecture, right? So that you know how requirements are related to each other. And design definition, I've already explained to you in strategy analysis, which is, you know, you, even though they explained it here, but it happens here, right? The solution. Solution is design. So you come up with solution option and then you come up with, you know, solution recommendation as well. Then you do requirement lifecycle management. Again, very important. You know, trace requirements, you prioritize requirements really well. Sorry, I'm just canceling this. So you prioritize, you trace requirements. So prioritize, as I told you, you know, prioritizing is an art, right? You do Moscow analysis. Right now, RISE technique has become very, you know, popular, only popular because it's a numeric way of doing the prioritization, but I've never seen anybody using that, doing that. So RISE is one, you know, and then you do a holistic analysis with respect to benefit, cost, and all of that in order to, you know, prioritize your requirements. So that is also, you know, very important. So what else we do? You get your requirements approved over here, you know, and you upload it in a SharePoint for reuse. So maintain requirements is also is something, because please remember, as an organization, you know, you have to make sure that the requirements are in reusable format so that tomorrow similar engagements are happening. They don't have to reinvent the wheel from scratch. And then we talk about solution evaluation, that BA does do testing, especially a lot of readiness testing. They do create test cases. They do validate those test cases, you know, whether they cover the entire requirement landscape. They execute those test cases as well. They analyze the, you know, test results. And so whenever a defect is raised, it will be assigned to a BA. So BA will decide whether it's a functional defect or it's an enterprise defect. And what is the best way to, you know, address that defect? So that is what solution evaluation is all about. Okay. So BA does a lot of role in solution evaluation. And that's the reason the kind of job BA does, quality assurance over here. I was telling you in the first session that a lot of quality people are getting, you know, moved into a BA role. In fact, I gave one session to Sapient around 3 years ago. And, you know, I traveled to Noida and we sat together. And over there, over the next 5 days, you know, when we sat together, their intent was they have a very big quality assurance team and they wanted, they handpicked some of the best performers and they wanted these people to start performing the role of a PA. So we trained all of them. So this is, you know, you have that growth path. So being a QA, you can definitely become a BA and then a product manager. Even if you are from a technology point of view, you know, the product mindset is applicable over there. So if you see the companies like Visa, Google, a lot of good people are working over there. My peers, all of them are technical people. And you know, they call themselves as now, you know, product manager technical. So product technical managers. So basically they own the technology of the product from a product mindset point of view. So product mindset is the future and everybody's talking about it. And the reason is whatever solution that you're working, you need to figure out how that solution can be enhanced in the future. Okay. Any question before we look at the Agile? Swati, you want to say something?
Oh, no, no questions from my.
Okay. So if you look at Agile, you know, Agile has become a fad, if you ask me. It's a very simple concept, and I don't know why there's so much hype about Agile. They came up with, you know, if you ask me what is Agile, it is a better way of working. And there are some reasons why it is a better way of working. We will discuss that. So just give me a minute.
Mohit?
Yeah.
Sorry to interrupt. Before we move on to the Agile, there is one part which I wanted you to throw some light on. Yeah. That when we are doing the solution evaluation, so at that time there is a process called defect triage. So basically, we are defect triage. So basically, to prioritize the defect which should be done on priority, which should be taken up first, something which is showstopper, something which is which we can do it later kind of a defect.
Yeah.
So. If you can, you know, tell us that what should be the approach for, because that is also expected from a BA only.
Yes.
So if you can, you know, give us some approach that how should we do it? What should be the criteria to do those things?
Absolutely. Thank you, Akbar. I'll explain that. So if you see here, you know, when, you know, defects come in. So when you are doing the impact analysis, so as a BA, so, you know, you can get defect for a particular functional specification, right? So what are the things I generally look at is traceability matrix, right? So basically, let's say if functional specification 15, there is a defect raised by a quality assurance guy. So when he raised that defect for defect number 15, you know, for functional specification number 15, I look at my traceability matrix. I understand that this functional specification 15 is mapped to this particular low level requirement, which is mapped to this particular business requirement, which is actually mapped to this particular value you know, or the benefit that we are trying to achieve as part of the value tree. So that is one. So that is very, very important that you understand that this defect that has happened, you know, is mapping to which business requirement. So as soon as you know that, you have defined the priority of the business requirement. In priority of the business requirement, you have done something called MOSCO, right? So must have, should have, could have, won't have. So if a defect comes in something like could have requirement, it is something you can live with it. You will figure out whether it is really required to be implemented, because it's a desirable requirement. But if a defect comes in something called must have, and that will become a showstopper. So if a BA is not able to figure out, if it's not able to do the impact analysis of the defect, so it means there are two things missing. One, traceability matrix is missing. So he's not able to understand which requirements are getting impacted. And also somewhere the priority of the requirements are not defined properly. And that's the reason he's not able to do the impact analysis and decide which defects should be prioritized over the other. In fact, whenever we go live, we never go live defect free. You know, always defect, just like a change is something which will always be there. Similarly, defect will always be there. Even Amazon has defect. You know, so many times when I use Amazon, I've seen that, you know, there are defects which are live, and definitely they keep on resolving. If you have a stand that I will resolve all the defects and then I'll go live, so, you know, best of luck to you. So we always have to prioritize as a PA that, okay, these are the defects which are showstoppers, which are not showstoppers. And then you move ahead. And how you do that is with the help of traceability matrix and then the priority of the requirement that you have developed or documented. Is it fine, Akbar?
Yes, thank you. So basically, just we have to trace back the defect back to the requirement, and on the basis of the requirements priority, we have to do the defect priority.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you, Akbar.
Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, no worries. Anything else from anyone before we move ahead? Okay, so now we look at Agile. So if you see, Agile is common sense, and you will see that when we were discussing Agile, that Agile is just, you know, little improved way of working. And we will understand why we call Agile as one or zero, because they are never, you know, in Agile, either you complete the requirement, right? There is no something called partially developed product, right? Or partially developed feature. So either it is complete or it is incomplete. So we'll discuss that as well. And there are various ways to actually, you know, achieve Agile, but all of the big frameworks that we have in the industry, you know, these two things are very important, that if any framework helps you improve your speed of delivery and the quality of delivery, then you can call it as Agile, as simple as that. Okay. So you will understand this slide once I'll give you an overview of what Agile is all about. And what I'll do is I have created a spreadsheet as well. Let me see if I've got the copy or not. Okay. I will figure it out. So, you know, after the break today, I will show you the spreadsheet as well, wherein, you know, I will explain you that how practically we do the Agile. Guys, just give me 2 minutes. I just need to bring water and then we'll get started. Okay, just give me 2 minutes. Hi guys. Yeah. So I hope everybody's there. Yeah. So am I audible? Anybody?
Yes. Yes. There?
Yes. Okay. Okay. Great. So
is Mohit audible?
You are mute now.
Oh, sorry. So, actually I have two control, one in the desktop and one over my headphone. So sometimes, you know, this confusion happens. Anyway, so if you see Agile, as I said, it is indeed, you know, common sense, and we'll talk about that as well. And one of the important thing is, in Agile, there is nothing called partially completed product. You have to have either a feature is complete or it's incomplete. And then speed and quality is very important. So now Agile started a long time ago. So this is the history of Agile. So Agile as a concept was started in a manufacturing firm, Toyota. So as I said, anything which helps you increase speed of delivery and quality of delivery is Agile. So when, let me, so if you see 1950s Toyota, they started something called lean manufacturing. Now lean manufacturing was all about reducing the waste. So what they used to do was they analyzed their manufacturing chain, and then they used to figure out what are the wastes they are producing in each of the step in that manufacturing, you know, process life cycle. And they try to address that waste and try to, you know, ensure that the speed and quality improves. So that is lean. And, you know, from there, the Six Sigma certification came in, if you know, which actually helps you define, measure, analyze, you know, interpret and control DMAIC process. So all of that, you know, came from this lean thinking, which was, brought into the market by Toyota. So then, you know, Harvard also, you know, if you look at Harvard Business Review 1986, they talk about, like, if you have to develop a new product, you know, they also spoke about Agile over there. But when it came to software industry, you know, the Agile started becoming popular in 2001. There's a lot of Agile methods came before 2001, apart from Lean, like Extreme Programming, you know, Scrum, DSTM. A lot of Agile methods were being conceptualized. Their framework were being developed, being discussed with industry leaders. But in 2001 was the time when the manifesto was created for Agile software development. So we'll talk about manifesto as well. And 2010 onwards, Agile became really popular and started getting implemented. So it was not like, you know, today somebody came up with a framework and next day we started using it. It takes a lot of time. So as you can see, you know, it roughly took around two decades just to people, you know, start talking about Agile and then start implementing Agile. So when I joined 2005, there was no Agile development at all. And I never saw anything till 2009 and 10, you know, any Agile development. There may be some Agile projects happening, but I was not part of that. When I did my MBA and when I came back from MBA and I went to Sydney, so there my eyes were wide open because everything was Agile. And not only Agile, it was scaled Agile, something called Scrum of Scrums. And everybody was working in that phenomena over there. And then 2-3 years, I did my MBA in 2010. So I passed out in 2011. So 2-3 years I spent over there. And when I came back to India in 2014, so then, you know, the reason I was hired in India was they wanted to go Agile. And so they were hiring all those people who already has worked in Agile way of working. So when I joined the bank in 2014, so next 2-3 years, the idea was definitely we have to create world-class products when it comes to payments. But also the way of working was being transitioned from waterfall to agile. And now you go to any bank, any organization, almost every one of them has something in agile. So this is how agile became popular. And the reason agile became popular, because these are the four things, you know, which agile proposes in terms of value. So the first is, in agile, the pace of delivering business value is much higher. So this green is agile and this dotted is waterfall. So if you're working in agile, so you're telling the business that you will get the value much faster as compared to waterfall. So I gave you a classic example, very simple example. When I did interiors for my flat 3 years ago, so those interiors, it was completely waterfall when they did. So, you know, in the beginning, they took the requirements from me. They developed the entire, you know, my flat, my interior. I just used to come, you know, they used to invite me maybe once in a few weeks. So the visibility, you know, finally I got my flat done in the end. So throughout the phase, there was no delivery to me. Okay, so, but in agile, when you work, you know, you start giving product much sooner. So we'll see that as well. So the pace of delivering business value in agile is much faster. So you talk about something called MVP, right? You talk about something called potentially shippable product. So this is what agile ensures, that the value is delivered at much faster pace to the business. The business has much more visibility. You can see that, right, to the product that is being developed. Whereas in waterfall, there is no visibility. There is visibility in the beginning because you are involved in gathering requirements. So that is the time they talk to you. During the execution, they do not involve you at all. And finally, the product is delivered to you. Whereas in agile, the product is being delivered to you every sprint or iteration. And that's the reason you have the visibility. Because you have the visibility, you know, the risk of not meeting the requirements is much less in agile, whereas very high in waterfall. Okay. Because let's say you got a visibility of the product being developed here, immediately you will tell them that this is not what you're looking for. You got it wrong. And immediately they will then start developing it in your, you know, expectation. So the risk of not meeting requirements in agile is much lesser. And adaptability is there in agile much more. Adaptability, because as I said, you can give feedback and tell the person that this is what you were not expecting as a business, and they can then incorporate your feedback. Okay, so business value, visibility, risk, adaptability, all of that is there when it comes to agile. Okay. So waterfall, what happens is, let's say you have all the requirements, A, B, C, D, E, F. You know, these are your PRD, let's say. Six requirements. Or you can say six features. You will capture the requirement for all the features in one go. Then you'll plan it in one go. You'll design for all of them in one go. Then you develop them in one go, then testing and then deployment. So this is the waterfall development. Whereas in agile, what you do is you break these features into, you know, various MVP, MVP 1, MVP 2, MVP 3. So A and B, let's say it becomes MVP. If I'm talking about a website, so I will tell my customer that, okay, in first phase, I will give you, you know, login. And then and apart from that login, it will be your account information services. So that's AB, right? CD will be focusing on payment initiation services. E and F could be focused on, you know, basic loan application. So this way you divide the entire scope of the project into various MVPs. And then for that MVP, you do the requirement planning, design, development, testing, deployment in one go. Okay. So in Agile, you try to break the entire, for example, even if the testing application that your guys are working, so you will, if you're working it from scratch, what Agile says is do not gather requirements for the entire application in one go. It's very, very tiring for the business also to give it to you all the requirement. So because even in your testing application, I'm assuming there will be admin module, there will be instructor module, there will be a student module or the exam participant module. I'm not from your domain, but I'm just visualizing. So there will be various modules, right? So if you're developing a new product from scratch, so it's always better to, divide them into logical modules. And then you develop that module in one go, show it to the customer, get that module right, then work the second module and then the third module. Okay, that is what Agile and Waterfall is all about. So this is what the manifesto, which was released in 2001.
Hello, Mohit.
Yeah.
So when we're doing it in Agile, although we are doing it in module wise, but in the beginning, we need to have the visibility that what is the overall, how many modules are there, whole scope. So yes. What is the level of documentation or what is the level of detailing we need to do in the beginning for that, so that we have all this scope?
Very nice. So basically, in the beginning, you do something called strategy analysis for sure. So strategy analysis is your, waterfall or agile agnostic. So basically, irrespective you're doing waterfall or agile, you do strategy analysis. So in strategy analysis, you will analyze all the modules at a high level, right? All the modules at a high level. And you will capture high level requirements for all the modules. And you will have a high level design for all the modules. Okay. So strategy analysis, irrespective, you eventually you go for waterfall or agile, you do it at a whole product level. But what BIBox says is that when it comes to low level requirement and low level design, don't do it for all the modules in one go. Definitely high level design and high level requirements, you do that at the complete product level. But when you start working on the low level requirement and for example, if I'm working on a website, so I need to understand the high level scope is login, lending, payments, account summary. And then I will design the website considering that these three major things I need to provide. Perfectly, I do that. But then when I'm deep diving into the payment, for example, low level requirement tells me if I have to do a domestic payment, what kind of fields are required in a domestic payment, right? What kind of fields are required in an RTGS payment? Similarly, low level design, will be into the, for the low level requirement. And also you do something called functional specifications, wherein you actually start designing the screens as well. So what Agile says is that do not capture low level requirement, low level design or functional specifications in the strategy analysis. Okay, in the strategy analysis, you keep it at high level. And now you will say, what do you mean by high level? There is a subjectivity involved, as simple as that. That depends upon your experience in that product. So if you are working on a product wherein you already have worked on a similar product, you will be in a position to gather more details even at the high level stage. But if you are working on a product where you have absolutely no clue about, then definitely there will be a lot of details which will not be included in high level, which will be you start capturing in LLR, LLD, and FS. Does that make sense, Akbar?
Yes, it does make sense. How should we ensure that because see, when you do the high level requirement, at that time with on that high level only you are doing all the planning for all the overall planning. The sprint, the costing, the overall plan. So
I understood your concern. Now you say that you have done the high level planning, and then how will you have real estimates for the plans? Because you have done only high level design, and you have to plan for time, cost, and scope, right? So, you know, in strategy analysis, we always have something called, you know, ballpark estimates. And when we have ballpark estimates, you know, if you look at the definition of ballpark estimate, you know, the variation could be plus minus 25%. So try to attain that much detail in strategy analysis so that you are in a position wherein you can give the estimate. And when you are giving the estimate to the sponsor with respect to time, cost, and scope, you tell them, you know, the variation could be plus minus 25%. As simple as that. And when you start working on the low-level requirement and LLD and FS, then you are able to come up with some definitive estimates wherein your, even there, the buffer that you need to maintain is plus minus 5%. So, you know, agile is not only from a delivery perspective, even the leadership mindset has to change. Because in waterfall, the reason waterfall was popular, because waterfall was supposed to tell them definitive estimates. See, ultimately it's all money, right? In waterfall, the good thing was you do so much detailing. If let's say Akbar, you are my sponsor. So I'll tell you, Akbar, I need $1 million for this project. And you knew that it's a waterfall. So the range that it could vary is only plus minus 5%. So if you are allocating funds for my project, so what you will not tell me, but you will have a 5% buffer. That's the, you know, tendency a sponsor used to do. But when they work on agile, the sponsor has to be educated that, you know, we are not giving you definitive estimates for now. It's just a strategy analysis we have completed, and the estimate could be plus minus 25%. So the level of detail that you have to gather in strategy analysis, it should be sufficient enough so that your ballpark estimate variation is not more than 25%. Does that make sense, Akbar? So education,
yes,
has to begin from leadership. So, I mean, they should also feel comfortable that they are not being provided definitive estimates. But, you know, what you promise to them is, I'm not able to give you definitive estimate, but I will give you a product which will meet customer requirement. Whereas in waterfall, they used to give definitive estimates, but then, and they used to assume that the product will be developed as per the customer expectation. But the problem was, at the end, the product was developed which was not meeting the customer expectation. So it's a trade-off, basically. So that's the reason now Agile has become popular, because now people have realized that all of us have a lot of options. So if you see in 2005, when we used to work with SBI, how many banks we had at that point of time in India, right? We had SBI, you know, we have few state banks. But now you look at the number of banks that we have in India, right? If I am, you know, new, you know, graduate, and if I have to open a bank account, let's say my personal bank account, I'm not talking about salary bank account, because salary bank account is defined by the organization. But if I have to open my personal bank account, wherein I will put in all my funds, I have a hell lot of banking options, like, you know, Kotak Mahindra Bank, DBS, you name the bank, you have it in India, which are offering retail CASA accounts. So if you are working in this such a challenging environment, even sponsor understand, you know, it's not that, you know, I want definitive estimate. What sponsor is more worried about in today's world is to develop a product which meet customer expectation. Because if you do not develop that, then, you know, we will not survive. So that's the reason Agile is becoming popular, because we are becoming more and more customer savvy. And the reason we are more and more becoming customer savvy, not because we love customer, because we have no option, right? Because as a customer, even if you see Amazon, why they are so customer centric? Because they know that if they are not customer centric, you know, people do have options. You know, I have Flipkart, and, you know, all my online needs can be, you know, provided by various merchant categories. So, for example, if you see for your toys, we have one app. I forgot the name of the app. You know, I used to buy a lot of toys for my daughter. So they used to provide me toys at a much better price and quality as compared to what I used to have in Amazon. I forgot that name. Yeah, very popular. Anyway, I mean, I have to go to my kids' bedroom to see to figure out that brand. But having said that, you know, in today's world we are living where cost doesn't matter much. You know, it does matter. It's not like you can have, you can ask for whatever you want, but the more important thing is customer expectation. So if you see the manifesto, you know, there's a little bit of way of working that has been changed. If you see, individual and interactions are being preferred over and above the processes and tools. So in waterfall, you know, you will have a lot of processes, a lot of tools, right? Whereas in Agile, it's all about interaction. This is very, very important. For example, if I write a requirement, see, I cannot write everything in requirement, as simple as that. You know, even if I have to explain a simple login page, and if I have to explain everything about that login page as a textual requirement, I will come up with at least, you know, 3 or 5 page of document. So that is something is really not possible. So what Agile says is interaction matters more over than processing and tools, and working software is more important than comprehensive documentation. So also when you are interacting with customer, you know, do not focus on documentation much, that you tell me everything, you write down everything, I'll write down everything, and then I'll get it approved from you. Working software speaks more. You know, listen to them, create whatever you have discussed, immediately create it, develop it, show it to them, ask them their feedback. That is more important. Customer collaboration over contract negotiation. So, you know, gone are the days when you tell customer that this is what you will give it to them, you know, and then you start negotiating over the contract. Now the customer collaboration is more important. So if they're asking for more features, if they're asking for changes, you know, don't tell them that it was never mentioned as part of the contract. So change, embrace change. Because if customer is asking for a change, you know, it's more likely because they're asking it because they need it. Definitely, you have to do the impact analysis, or, you know, you can't blindly believe your customer. Because even me as a customer, you know, sometimes even I am not sure what I am looking for. So, and when I start using the product, then I realize that this was in fact I was looking for. It happens, right? When you buy something new, I bought a new car a couple of years back. Initial few days, I was very unhappy that, you know, I should have gone for that model. This doesn't meet my expectation. But you won't believe, now I love my car. So you know, customer collaboration is very important. You know, tell them you use your product for some time, and if you still don't like it, we are more than happy to change it for you. Rather than telling them, this is what you signed for, this is what you will get. And then responding to change and over following a plan. So this is your answer, Akbar, that, you know, you'd never go for definitive estimate in strategy analysis. So you always have that buffer plus minus 25%, because that gives you, you know, space to respond to a change rather than just strictly following the plan. Okay. So that is also very, very important. Okay. So we now look at what is the life cycle of the project. So you do project initiation. So project initiation is nothing but strategy analysis that you do. So you actually do strategy analysis here completely, right? And you do the release planning at a very, very high level as well. So release planning, remember the change strategy doc that you prepared. So for example, project initiation is a website. You will say that I want to develop login, account summary, payments initiation, and your loan application. So you do the release planning at a very high level that, okay, you know, after 2-3 months, I will give login, then account summary, then payments, and then loan application. These are very, very major modules of the bank. So you do the release planning at a high level. So this is all, these two is strategy analysis. Project initiation plus release planning is strategy analysis. Then you do the iteration setup. So iteration zero is all your infrastructure setup. So basically, you know, you will onboard your team. You will give them laptops, you will give them softwares. If you are having Jira, you will install Jira, all of that. So iteration zero is your infrastructure setup. It could be 1 to 4 week, depending upon how big is your team. Then you start developing in iterations. So it could be, we call it a sprint. Iteration is nothing but sprint. So you say that, okay, generally industry goes for 2 week sprint. Some people go for 1 week. So the industry recommendation is 1 to 4 week. I personally believe 1 week is too less. 4 week is really long. So we'll go for 2 week iterations, right? So you develop that product in 2 weeks. So for example, if I'm working on login, so let's say I have a landing page and login page and then home page. So this is my login functionality, right? So what I will do is in first 2 weeks, I will create landing page. Next 2 week, I will create login page. Next 2 week, I'll create home page. So in total of 6 weeks, you will be able to have the login functionality ready. So this is how you develop in iteration. The reason you develop in iteration is because let's say you are Akbar, you are my customer. You gave me the requirements for login functionality, which is fine. And looking at your requirements, I analyzed that I will require 6 weeks to develop login functionality. So now I understand that it's very probable that it's not possible for anyone to give complete requirements in one go. Really not possible. If let's say you're doing, you know, interior for your flat, you bought a new flat and you're doing interiors for your flat, right? I'm an interior service provider. Can you give me the requirements for your bedroom, your living room, kitchen, everything in one go? It's not possible, right? Because requirements do change, your understanding do change. So what I do is, you know, even if you gave me the login requirements at a high level, that you want a password, you want captcha code, you want, you know, maybe an OTP for risky customer. You gave me all of that, but I develop in iteration. I'll show it to you that this is how it is looking like. And then I will gather your feedback. It might happen, you might say that, you know, the captcha code is unnecessary. Initially, you thought you need captcha code to prevent, you know, robotic attacks. But then you figured out that captcha code is unnecessary. And if you ask me, you know, there are a couple of websites, especially in the US, I hate the captcha code they use. You know, they give you some images and then they say that, you know, select those images where you see the lamppost. You keep on selecting them and it never, you know, give me a success result. I don't know why. Very confusing. So you, once you see that, you realize that I don't need this. It's unnecessarily creating a pain in customer login. So development iterations happen. So let's say you created this login functionality in 3 iterations, 1, 2, 3, right? You created that login functionality and login was an MVP. Then you do the pre-release. So what is pre-release? You do the final testing end-to-end, right? Landing page, login page, home page. You did the final testing. Basically, in pre-release, you put your code in staging environment, right? It's a replica of production environment. And you invite your user, you again do the UAT, you make sure that they are happy. You know, everything is working fine, there are no defects. And then you go into the production. So if you see waterfall, agile is absolutely similar. I'm getting some chats. It's not Hamless, Gaurav, I'm not that rich guy. So it is something different, I'll let you know. It's a very cost-effective type provider. So basically, finally, you go for, you know, production. Okay, so now you understand agile and waterfall. So if you see agile and waterfall, basically you are giving scope to the customer that they are having the visibility of the product that you're developing. You see this visibility here. You're giving them the option of adaptability so that they can adapt to change in requirements, right? So that is over there as well. Oh, so, right, adaptability, visibility. So you do a lot of stuff over here. The risk of not meeting requirements is less because you are showing it to the customer continuously. So if you look at the first slide that we did, this one, business value, visibility, risk, adaptability, all is happened because you're developing in iterations and showing it to the customer. Okay, so that is also very, very important. So if you see what is iteration look like, I'll show you that as well. You know, so if a 2 week iteration, day 2 week means 10 business days, right? So day one, you will do the planning that what you're gonna do for next 8 days. Last day, you don't do anything. First day, you don't do anything. 8 days, which is in between, you actually do the, you know, development. Okay. So day one, you plan that this is what you will develop. So let's say you picked up landing page. So you plan that, okay, we have picked up the landing page. You will understand landing page internally. You figure out that you see there might be a front end engineer, there might be a middleware, then there will be a back end engineer. You will ensure that all of them understand the requirement, which is the, you know, landing page. Then there will be a tester as well. Then all of these four people, they'll develop that landing page. And the last day, you know, you do the iteration review. Basically, you look at the landing page that has been developed by them. You give a demo of that landing page to the customer and seek their feedback, whether they're happy or not. And you do the retrospective as well, right? Wherein you understand whether, you know, let's say the feedback was really not great. So you do the retrospective that what could we do in the next sprint so that we can get better feedback from the customer. And not only that, every day you have a daily stand-up wherein all your developers, front-end engineer, middleware, your database administrator, your tester, 15 minutes you catch up and you say that, you know, you ask everybody, are you happy? Do you understand what we're doing? Is there any confusion? And then you are ready by the last day. On the last day, you don't do nothing, right? You just give the demo, you do the retrospective and that's it. So, you know, why I loved CBA was when I used to work in Sydney. You know, last day we always used to have drinks over there. So that was the culture that at the end of every 2 week, you know, we used to work for 2 weeks and last day, you know, my scrum master, I'm still very fond of him. And, you know, I speak to him almost on a regular basis, even though it's been more than 10 years that we have worked together. One of the best scrum masters I had. So, you know, we all, the entire team used to celebrate. We used to go to, you know, so what I saw was moving from waterfall to agile. In waterfall, you know, we do a lot of, there is somehow, the reason is because you develop all the requirements in one go, then you develop it. We do not have understanding of the requirements because see, just understand, a BRD will have around roughly, if you're launching a new CASA account, a BRD will have roughly around 500 requirement, right? First, for a BA himself, it's impossible to understand those 500 requirements. Trust me, even a BA himself will not understand. He will claim that he understands because he has written those. Forget developer and tester will understand those. So there was a lot of, you know, even if we, during the development, we were really confused. And the BA, you know, he wrote it like 2-3 months ago, that BRD. He used to take time to recall what he has written. So that became a problem. But in Agile, because we are working on a very, very small scope at a time. So I'm just working on landing page. And all of our energy is focused on getting the landing page right. And we knew that we have to give a demo to the customer. He will give us feedback. And depending on his feedback, we'll do the retrospective. And then we start building the login page in the next iteration. Make sense? So this is what we call as sprint. As simple as that. So in a sprint of 2 weeks, day one and last day, which is day one is Monday. Let's say Monday you start your sprint. Last day is Friday. In between 8 days, you will not do anything. Any question, please? Okay. And this is how your project looks like. So your stakeholders, you know, these are your stakeholders whom a product owner interacts. So they are the one who give you requirements. So they could be your business, legal, compliance. So this Scrum team, when you are a developer, tester, you know, they never interact with stakeholder. So the product owner interacts with them. So what DAVOX is, from not DAVOX, Agile says is that if everybody is talking to each other, you know, it will create a confusion. So product owner talks to them. He gets the requirements. So after the break, we look at the backlog as well. And then the Scrum team, you know, they work on those requirements in iterations. And since there are so many people involved, we have a Scrum Master. You know, he's nothing but a project manager who manages all of these resources. So he could be a front-end engineer, she could be a middleware, he could be a database administrator, she's a quality assurance guy, person, she, you know, is a UX developer, let's say. So this is technology. So Scrum Master is a technology manager who is actually acting as a project manager as well. Whereas the product owner, he or she should be a tech savvy, so that he understands the technical constraints and all. But more than that, you know, he is the person who is more focused on the business. That is how the agile way of working. So product owner is the one who creates a backlog. So after the break today, I will show you a sample backlog as well. So he creates a backlog, right? But that backlog is executed. Backlog is nothing but your BRD and your requirements, right? This backlog gets executed by the Scrum team. Any question, please? So this is how it looks like. This is a little complicated diagram. I don't like it. So as a product owner, I create a product backlog, which has user stories. I do the estimation as well, right? Then, you know, we have a sprint backlog. Then we have a product increment and so on. So I'll show you, just give me a minute. So this, you know, you create a little various type of stories like epic stories and all. So we'll talk about that as well, and you prioritize that as well. So let me show you, just give me a minute, a sample. I need to retrieve it from my database. I think I showed you in one of the class as well. Right. So if you see here, you know, what we'll do today after the break is I'll show you this, you know, epic stories and everything, that how I created all of that. Very simple. Again, new internet banking portal, right? So we'll discuss that for sure today. It won't take much time. It's very simple. But what you need to understand is that, you know, that you create a product backlog, it is nothing your BRD, right? So if you have BRD, we have 500 requirements. We will have 500 requirements here, okay? So what is the sprint backlog? It is, you break down that product backlog into sprint backlog. So it becomes a smaller BRD for your sprint. So when you are working here, you know, day one, you will, from the entire product backlog, you will pick few requirements that you will develop in this sprint. So that becomes your sprint backlog. So basically backlog for that sprint. So you have the sprint backlog, 2 week sprint, you daily Scrum call you have, remember I told you daily Scrum call, And then after the sprint, when that sprint backlog is completed, that sprint backlog is nothing but the product feature that you have developed. They call it product increment. So you developed one feature. You showed that feature in the sprint review to the business. They accepted that feature. You did the retrospective of the sprint, that if, let's say, you know, some feedback was given, some positive, some negative, you did the retrospective, whether you are working well or not. And then you do that in a cyclic manner. Then again, from the product backlog, you will pick up the another feature, which is nothing but your sprint backlog, again, develop that feature. That feature gets added to your product that you're developing. Again, you give a demo of that feature, you do the retrospective of the sprint. Again, you come back here and you just follow that in iteration. Make sense? Okay, so we'll see that today. And then also we have something called, you know, in a product backlog, you do have some epic stories. Epics are nothing but your high level business requirement. You break down into low level business requirement, which are nothing but stories. Okay, as simple as that. So I will show you that as well. Because in waterfall, you have something called, you know, BRD, low level requirement, functional specifications, and so on. In Agile, we don't follow that terminology. In Agile, we have BRD becomes epics. You know, your low level requirements becomes, and functional specifications become stories. As simple as that. So it's a very simple way of documenting requirement. The reason why we have a very simple way of documenting that requirement, because as I said, Agile focus more on communication rather than documentation, right? So they say you write epics. So then you break down those epic into stories, and that is what is your product backlog. And then you pick up some of the epic for your sprint, which is nothing but a sprint backlog, and you deliver it. And also finally, you do the prioritizing of the product backlog. So when you are doing the prioritizing, you know, all your epics which are must have, again, the same prioritizing technique, must have, should have, could have, won't have. So must have epics will be on top. Then you will have your should have, then could have, and then finally won't have. So when you are planning the sprints, you know, you will first pick up the must have epics. You will deliver those epics in sprints. Once must have is completed, then you will do a should have, then you will do could have, and won't have is something you will never do, because those were something, you know, not relevant in today's scenario. Does that make sense to everybody? I hope, you know, now you are able to visualize that Agile is actually, you know, not that complicated. It's just a fad that has been developed. It's just a simplified way of working, or you can say efficient way of working and delivering value to the customer. Any question from anyone, please? Any question? Okay.
Do we have any difference between iterative waterfall and agile?
So, Akbar, iterative waterfall, remember what I did in SPI? So the iterative waterfall is hybrid. The only difference is that the sprint in Agile, the sprint will be 1 to 4 week, right? And generally the tendency is 2 week. The industry standard is 2 week. In iterative waterfall, the sprint becomes, you know, 3 months, 5 months, 6 months. So what Agile says is that if you break down the scope into, you know, 3 months, 6 month duration, then again, you are losing connect with the customer. So don't go for that long, you know, releases, which we happened in iterative waterfall. Whereas in Agile, you just focus on 2 weeks. So 2 weeks is the industry standard that we follow. This is more, see, one is you talk to customer daily. If you talk to customer daily, then you will not be able to do any work, right? So if customer is standing in front of you on a daily basis, then definitely you will not be able to do anything work. So over interaction is also not good. But what over the experience we have seen is 2 weeks. So you tell customer every 2 weeks, we will invite you, we will show it to you. That is Agile. But if you are telling customer, we will invite you after every 3 months, iterative waterfall, which we did in SBI. Not 3 months, it was 6 months. Then there is a complete waterfall wherein we'll tell you customer that come back after 2 years and then we will show you the product. Now you understand difference, Akbar?
Yes.
Okay. Any other question, please, before we take a break? From anyone? So you will... you're saying something? Somebody?
Not from my end.
Okay. So I will show you this, you know, after the break. It's a very, very simple way of understanding a pile of you know, agile more. I will show you that, you know, the epic that I have created, the stories that I have created, very simple. You know, ceremonies I've already discussed with you, planning, daily scrum meeting and all. So I will show you after the break today, and then you will be able to appreciate little more from a practicality point of view. Okay. So we'll take a break. When do you guys want to come back? We'll take maybe 20 minute break. Will that be suffice? So we can come back 9:50. Okay. So right now it's 9:30. So we will come back 9:50. Thank you. Thank you, guys. We'll see you at 9:50. I hope you are liking today's session. I'm trying to make it as practical as possible. And we'll come back at 9:50 a.m. Thank you.
Hi everyone. Let me know once you are back. Thank you for the confirmation. So I was just talking to Lakshmi during the break. We need this feedback to be, completed. So meanwhile, people are joining back again. If you can please take a minute and submit this feedback, that will be very helpful. So I've given the link in the chat. It will just take... So it will take only 2 minutes. So we'll start in then 5 minutes. Okay, so please take 2 minutes and then complete this link. And meanwhile, I hope others will also join. We'll just give 5 minutes more. Somebody just reached, 2-3 people have reached out to me to share the link again. We'll start exactly at 10, okay? And then we'll look at the spreadsheet.
Yeah, Mohit.
Thank you, Rahul. Thank you. Meanwhile, anybody want to discuss anything? Thanks, Kaurav, Surbhi, Abhashi.
Mohit, give me a feedback link.
Okay, I'll place it. Done. I've just typed in the chat.
Have we started or we have time?
I think we can get started now. Thanks everybody for submitting the feedback. Let me share my screen now. I will show you a very simple case study, and you know, it will be a very good overview of the HI. So if you see here, you know, let's say you're developing, this is the case study that we are working on. So let's say you're developing a new internet banking portal for young customer segment of the bank. So if you see, especially in Europe, you know, a lot of the big banks, they are actually developing the new banking portal, especially the mobile app. You know, all the previous banking portal that they have, they are completely legacy based. And, you know, the response time is very, very slow. And the look and feel is not great. And if you try to upgrade the look and feel now, it will take a lot of time. So what they have decided, and I'm telling you, this is the fact that we have to develop everything from scratch. And this new product that they will develop, it will be microservices based. It will be completely new state of the art. And you know, and they will be able to give real-time decisioning, especially in case of loan application. So that is what they are developing. And what they're doing is they are, you know, they're developing this product and they're not offering this product to all the customers. So they're offering it to select customers. And you know, then they will slowly pace it up so that their existing channels are also relevant. And also the new product that they're developing, you know, you can't just replicate all the features in one go. So existing channel, which they developed over the, you know, 30, 40 years, you know, it will take time for the new product that they're developing to scale up to that level. But they are coming up with a lot of exciting features, new features. And slowly, slowly, the idea is to migrate from the existing product, existing channel to the new channel. So that is the thought process. Almost every bank, when you say in Europe, you know, or especially in Europe, this tendency is more as compared to US. So if you are working on that vision, you know, and we know the problem, it is out of date, a lack features that young customer expect, you know, they buy it, resulting in low NPS score. So if you see, you know, the features like cross-border transfer. So right now, what people are expecting is, if you're doing a cross-border transfer, if you're based out of in London and you send your money to someone in New York, So A, they want transparency in pricing. B, they want ability to track cross-border payment. Basically, they should know when it is getting credited, the amount is getting credited, right? So all of that, the customers are expecting, which is not possible to implement in legacy channels. So you understand that problem, the root cause, and then you come up with all these root cause in detail. So if you see, you know, a lot of paperwork required for applying new products. I'm just giving you an example. You know, the current website has features which are not required, difficult to navigate, not mobile savvy, you know, lack several options such as tax payments, recharges, and bill payment. Now, this is becoming very popular. You know, tax payments, recharges, your mobile recharges, and bill payments. So that is something which is not possible, you know. The real-time status of various requests are not reflected on the website. I spoke to you about cross-border. So you know, all that becomes the root cause of the problem, and that's the reason you are developing a new internet banking portal. So if you are working now, this entire spreadsheet, I have given a very simple example, but it is nothing but you're doing strategy analysis. See, you're defining the vision, you're understanding the current state, right? So you do that current state analysis really well. And in order to help you doing that current state analysis, you sometimes, you know, even do the persona. So for example, you ask your business, like, who will be using this internet banking portal, the new one? So the business can say that it could be a retail banking customer, it could be an NRI customer, right? And when I say NRI customer, who is not, it should be not an NRI, to be honest. It should be, you know, someone who is not in London. We're taking the example of in London over here. Then small business customer, you know. So these are the three customer types. So when you do current state analysis, you know, even in Agile, you will make sure that you understand these three personas really well. So you take an example out of these three customer segment. For example, I just took an example of Shadab, that, you know, Shadab is someone who is this, he's the guy, this is his goals, you know, what is the typical system uses, what is the preference, you know, you try to get some details. The reason you do this user persona is because when you are analyzing the current state and writing the epics, it helps you understand your customer really well. If you ask me, it helps you visualize your customer, right? So it helps you visualize your customer. So you do that, these personas as well. Then you start writing epics, as simple as that. So now you understand the vision, you understand the problem, root cause, you understand the personas, you start writing epics wherein you said, okay, you know, now you are working on a new internet banking product. So you said you need landing page, you need login functionality, home page, payments, loan application features, logout. Now, you know why we call it as epic? Because these are very, very high level requirement, right? If you see, login could be of many types, right? Amazon, they have multiple ways of login. Your ICICI. You can log in via password, OTP. You can log in via your biometric.
even by your card details, you know, the forgot password. So there could be so many things which will be there in login functionality. But when you are writing epics, you're not, you know, going into that level of detail. Just at a very high level, what is the login functionality that you are working on? You know, so you need the login functionality. Maybe you can break down at a very, very high level that these are the various type of login options we want to provide, but you will not describe those login option for sure. Okay. Similarly, homepage, you will tell that which kind of type of accounts you want to support, like current account, saving account, fixed deposit, recurring deposit, you know, the payments, the kind of payments you want to support. So epics are very, very high level. And similarly, you define the acceptance criteria. So acceptance criteria is, you know, for example, if you're saying payments, you will say that as part of the payments, I need RTGS, NFT, you know, what kind of payments I need. So that is an acceptance criteria of that epic. So acceptance criteria means basically when business will accept that you have delivered payment functionality. Okay. So at a very, very high level, you mention the, you know, sub features of that particular high level feature that we have mentioned over here. So if you ask me, this acceptance criteria over here acts like a low level requirement. Okay. So for example, he's saying domestic payment, international payment, let's say they are two epic. So domestic payment, what if I talk about this domestic payment in London, we have CHAPS, which is like RTGS. Right, we have faster payment system, you know, which is like your IMPS. We don't have anything equivalent for NFT over there. Then you have BAX, which is equivalent to ECS. You know, then you so these become domestic payment type. So you mentioned that here, that what domestic payment type we want to offer in online banking. Similarly, if you written down international payments. In London, we have international payments, not only cross-border transfer, but you have something called, you know, Euro payment transfer, like SEPA, you know, SEPA credit transfer, SEPA, you know, instant credit transfer, SEPA direct debit. So you will mention all of that in the acceptance criteria, which is nothing but the low-level requirement for your project. So this is the way you write epics. And then what you do is, you know, you do the estimation. So we'll talk about estimation for now. So if you see, in order to do estimation at the epic level, you have to break epic into stories, right? So what is the story? So if you see here, now you said that epic is landing page, right? Now, when you break this high level requirement, so I just broke this requirement for you. So for example, this is the landing page. So I said, now, if you see, there will be three different types of landing page, depending upon whether you are retail banking customer, small business. So if I open, maybe let's say, you know, ICICI Bank website. Later. So you see, these are like personal landing page, NRI. So by default, it comes personal because majority of the people they support is personal, but they do have people who are NRI, they do have people small business, then they do have large businesses which are like corporate. So depending upon your business type, you will have different landing page. So you will create different landing pages. So these become your stories. For each of the landing page, like retail banking customer, what you need, you write the acceptance criteria. So over here, you look at the screen level, right? So for example, if you're a retail banking customer, like I am the retail banking customer, let's say, personal. So I need, you know, menus item like account, card, loans, investment, which is nothing, your FD, RD, goal-based loaning, insurance, payments, offers. So all of that becomes the acceptance criteria of this particular story, okay? So when you are looking at stories, always remember you start looking at the screen level. Okay. The reason you do that at screen level is, I'm just giving you an example. So you are able to estimate for that. So when I define the screen for, and whenever I, you know, create a story, I always create a prototype. So
So I work with the developer, they create the UX screen, and then they give you the prototype. And then you, because see, if I have to explain someone this to developer, you know, I can write so much details in the acceptance criteria and stories that, you know, it will become very big. So it is not even possible. So what Agile always says is work with UX developer and create a prototype, because pictures speak 1,000 words. Okay. I keep my details at a very high level here. Now what I do is I do the story estimation. So story estimation is basically, you know, I invite my developers, testers, you know, Scrum Master is there. They do the story estimation, which is like they say how much time they need to develop this story. So what Agile earlier used to say is that when you are estimating story, you know, do not correlate story with the man days. But now, since we are working in a complex projects and programs, if you see the scale Agile, they say that one story point is nothing but one man day. So let's say if you have to work on this retail banking customer's page, you need one development day of work, let's say, and one testing day of work. That's it. So it means it is two story point of work. Okay. So how you do that two story point estimation? There are multiple ways. You can do historical analysis. If you have done it before, if you have created a landing page for some another website, you know how much time you took over there. You do something called t-shirt sizing. So what we do is like all the stories that we hear, we classify them as, you know, small, medium, complex story, a small, medium, large story. So all the small stories, we gave a thumb rule, will be like three story point. All medium 5, all large 8. So, you know, whenever we look at the story, we say it's a small story, medium story, large story. If everybody's saying small story, okay, three story part. So that is also one way. Another way is affinity sizing. So what you do is you do the story point estimation for one story, like I have done it for this one. Then all subsequent stories, you compare it, that story with the benchmark story. And you say if a benchmark story requires two story point, if I have to compare this story, you know, how much time will it take? So you do the comparison analysis and you figure out that if it's taking two story point here, it should take three story point. Sometimes we do planning poker. So planning poker is, you know, what I'll do is I'll say, okay, this is retail banking customer story that I want to work on. So I will ask all of you, okay, what do you think? Let's say you are all my Scrum team. I will ask all of you how much story point you think will it will take. So Akbar will say 3, Swati will say 2, somebody will say 1. So when they say all of that, then we will come try to come to an agreement. So first of all, we pick up that story point estimation, which majority of the people are claiming. So if most of you are saying 2 story point, we will discuss why 2. We will ask anybody who challenges it. If there are no challenges, we'll go ahead for 2 story point. So it is planning poker. So there are various ways of story estimation. If you ask me what I generally do is, I generally do, you know, a mix of historical analysis, affinity sizing and t-shirt sizing. I generally don't do planning poker. Planning poker generally you do, you know, when, let's say, you foresee that there is a lot of difference in opinion. Then you go for planning poker so that you are able to gather all the opinion in the planning estimate. But till now, I've never come across a case where people are, you know, there is a lot of conflict in for estimation for a particular story. So I generally do historical analysis, t-shirt sizing, affinity sizing, you know, a mix of three can be used. And then, you know, I come up with the estimation. So this way I estimate at a story level. And when you estimate at a story level, you know, you sum up all the stories that you have written for this epic, and this way you get the epic story estimation. Does that make sense to everybody? So estimation at epic level is very difficult. We do it at strategy analysis, but then, you know, the range is minus plus 25%, right? So how we come with definitive estimates? When we break down epic into stories, and then when we do the estimation at story level, then we are able to get the, you know, estimation at the epic level. Does that make sense to everybody? So we call it as, you know, story estimation, which we sum it up to come the estimation at the epic level. Any question till now, please? Okay, very simple concept. It's more like, you know, when I worked on Agile in Sydney, and when I came back, and as I said, one of our agenda was to move to Agile. I could see there was a lot of confusion. There was a lot of concern, fears for Agile, and stakeholders were saying they were not ready. You know, the biggest roadblock was making leadership understand that you will not get definitive estimates in Agile way of working. You have to work with buffer. So you have to work with buffer, and, you know, and you can't, your vision, your, you know, goal should be to meet customer requirement, customer expectation, and not to meet your, you know, triple constraint. So triple constraint is nothing but the scope, time, cost. So you have to come out of that agenda. So that was my biggest challenge, to somehow convince the leadership that, you know, scope, time, and cost definitely is important, but then customer expectation management is far more important. Okay, you might spend more, but if you're able to delight your customer, it will truly reward you. So that was the cultural change that we brought in, and it is really, you know, reaping awards now. But please do remember that at epic level, the estimation, when you do, it is always at the ballpark level. Only when you break down into stories, then you are able to get the real estimate. Okay. You also do release planning. So basically what you do in release planning is, as I said, you decide sprint duration, and generally it is 2 weeks. So sprint zero, I told you, right? It is, again, let's say it was 2 weeks, you do the infra setup. So simply infra setup you do, which is basically your, you know, getting the laptops ready and everything. Then you started doing the sprint 1, 2, 3, 4. And finally the release 1 was the minimum viable product that you gave. So what is release 1 is, if you look at my epic, so you said that, you know, epic 1 and 2, if you look at the epic 1 and 2 was landing page and login functionality, let's say. So I'm just giving you an example, even though it doesn't sound like an MVP, landing page and login page only, but let's say it's an MVP. So you tell your customer that you will be very soon getting a product, a beta level, we call it beta level, which will have a landing page and login page. And that is your release 1, because it's a minimum viable product. Why it is a minimum viable product? It's a minimum set of features required by the customer to use the product, right? Without this, he can't even use your product, start using those products. So you come up with release 1 to the customer. So release 1 is basically going live in production. So after every sprint, you do not go live in production. That's the biggest mistake we do. After every sprint, you come up with potentially shippable product. Okay. You just keep it there in the staging environment. Sprint 2, you add some more features. Sprint 3, you add more features. Sprint 4, you add. Sprint 4 is generally a, you know, buffer sprint. See how much buffering we do. You know, even though we are doing sprint level estimation, and even then, you know, best way to go Agile is you should have a buffer sprint before you go on to release. Because in buffer sprint, you do the leftover work, your final testing, and then you go for release. And that is what is your minimum viable product. Okay. So minimum viable product, this is what, you know, the product manager or owner has to decide all this release planning, that release 1, I will release this set of features. These are must-have features. Release 2, he could focus on, should have. Release 3, he could focus on, could have. As simple as that. Okay. And for every release, he has the sprints now. That sprint 1, 2, 3, these are the sprints required, right? The estimation of work which is delivered in each of the sprints. You might mention that as well. And this way, you, when you present to the business, who is the sponsor, you tell them, I am working on a website. Release 1, you will have login functionality, landing page. Release 2, you will have home page and account summary, account services. Release 3, you will have payments and lending, right? Release 1 will go after end of 4 sprint. Release 2 will go off after 3 sprints. Release, final release will again go after 3 more sprints, right? Now you have all the sprint durations here, 2 weeks. By this, you will be able to figure out that this is the, you know, high level timeline for this particular website. And also, every releases, you also plan for sprint buffer. That is very, very important because, you know, even if you plan your best, so for example, even if, let's say we do, you know, we all do studies, right? We do studies and, you know, we study a book in iteration. And I say, okay, today I will finish one chapter. Tomorrow I will finish second chapter. Monday, third chapter. So even I do my best. You know, I'm the only person who is working. I'm the only person who is reading. There is no other person involved. But still, I'm not able to finish that chapter that day. So just imagine if team is working together, even if they tried their best to do planning, it is very probable that, you know, and at the end of the, you know, sprint, they realized that they were not able to complete some work. Or there was change requested by the customer, right? You thought you will read this chapter today, and then while reading the chapter, you realize you need to read something else as well. Otherwise, your learning will not complete. So at an individual level, when you go through so much change, so at a team level, definitely you will go through some change, right? So buffering of sprint, of having a sprint, buffer sprint is very, very important. So with this, you know, when you add a lot of buffer in your releases, this way some you are become in a position wherein you are able to give a definitive estimate to the business that I will be able to go live by March. And even there, you know, after having all the buffer and all, you still have plus minus 5% of buffer on top of that. So that is kept by the sponsor. So when he gives plus minus 5% of buffer, and then if you are telling your sponsor that I will go live, I will be able to go live final with all the features by 31st of March, when your sponsor is communicating to his boss, you know what he will tell? We will be able to go live by April, end of April. So this is how, you know, manifesto, if you look at the manifesto again, let me show you the manifesto. Customer collaboration over contract recognition, responding to change over following a plan. So these two aspects is very, very important. This is business aspect. So you won't believe when we went agile, every, you know, seat, we printed this manifesto and we pasted this manifesto throughout the floor. And we tell them you have to remind, you know, we wanted people to be very, very remindful of this manifesto because generally it is a tendency to negotiate the contract and following a plan. It's a tendency, right? So, but practicality is you cannot guarantee that there will be no change in the plan. As simple as that. I mean, I gave you a very classic example as an individual also, if you start reading today, you know, if you are not keeping buffer, let's say, you know, you're reading for a Saturday exam and Monday to Friday, you kept zero buffer, right? Trust me, there is a high probability you will not able to complete your syllabus. You know, we used to do that. So what I used to do was Monday to Thursday, I used to plan, I will complete my syllabus. Friday, I used to keep a buffer and revision, and then I was able to sit for the Saturday exam. So the same policy we have to apply at the team level. Okay, so this is what we do. And sprint ceremonies, I already told you that day one you do sprint planning, right? So whole day you do the planning that what all stories you will pick, how we will develop those stories. Then day two to day nine, you do the daily scrum meeting wherein you just keep a track if anybody is facing any issues or somebody has a query. And final day, you do sprint review and sprint retrospective. Review, you do it to the business. They look at your landing page that you have developed, whether they're happy or not. And if they're happy, they'll give you the, you know, good feedback. If not, then they will give you some constructive feedback. There is no something called negative feedback. We call it constructive.
Then you do retrospective, wherein you understand how you can do better in future sprint, right? So that is very, very important aspect. You do that. And this is what it is. So if you see, this is what Agile is all about. So, you know, people have made it so complex that, for Agile, you need that. Agile is nothing but change of mindset, as simple as that. And not only from a Scrum team point of view, which probably all of you are, but also from leadership point of view. So that giving more importance to scope, time, and cost constraint, they should give more importance to meeting customer expectations. So if they have that mindset change, Agile will be successful. If not, then even if you're claiming Agile, all of you have waterfall mindset. Any questions, please? So this is what I wanted to tell you about Agile, that, you know, if you ask me that if you have to begin Agile, all you need to do is two things. One is, you know, have a buy-in from the leadership, train them on Agile, right? The first training that I conducted in the bank was the leadership, wherein I told them what is Agile all about. We actually had a Lego game. We, you know, created that Lego game. We asked them to work on developing a city through that Lego. And we asked them to first do that in waterfall manner, and then I told them to do that in Agile manner. So when they did that, they realized that, you know, in waterfall, even though they completed on time, but the city that they developed was completely opposite of what they wanted to achieve. In Agile, they were much more closer to their expectation, even though it took a little bit of, you know, longer time. And with time, you know, you can even manage your scope, time, cost, even in Agile way of working. Well, everybody works in an Agile environment. You can definitely manage your scope, time, cost better as you become more proficient. So the first thing you need to do is train your leadership. And the second thing you need to do is hire Scrum Masters. The reason is because Scrum Masters are the one, you know, who will install Jira in your, you know, infrastructure, wherein you install, you know, upload epics, you upload your stories, you do the sprint planning. The Jira is a platform. So you need to have that Scrum Master, because little technical expertise required to manage Jira. So if you have a Scrum Master, you have trained your people, leadership, your people from Agile basic concepts. And Scrum Master is the one who ensures that all these sprint ceremonies are being conducted in the way it should be conducted, like sprint planning. Remember I told you my favorite Scrum Master from the bank, from Sydney. So that time he was one of the first Scrum Masters across the bank, you know, he got trained. So we used to have a lot of fun in planning daily Scrum meeting. We used to have fun. It was fun working, you know, even though it was a complex project we were working, but we used to have a lot of fun. Then we used to give working demo to the customer. Customer used to have fun, you know, used to give us constructive feedback. We used to have retrospective, and then we used to have drinks and all. So that is something, what I'm saying is, if you do Agile and, you know, it gives visibility to customer. Customer is happy. Leadership is happy because customer is happy. And the Scrum team is happy because, you know, they have complete understanding of what they need to do every day, because they have divided the entire work into two weeks. They start that 2 week iteration first with the planning, then they do that, and then they give a demo. So even the Scrum team is happy, customer is happy, business is happy, and that's why Agile is successful, if you do it in a right way. Any question, please, from anyone? Any, you guys are trying to achieve Agile in small way, or?
Okay. I will ask this question to, not question, but in fact, I will conduct it as a discussion, especially Akbar, Ashish, Selesh, and Neelam would be appreciate this. In real-time environment, they have faced these challenges. So like what you have, what we have seen, we are doing some project. We have developed a particular stage till the time we have defined the BRS. And after that, we are getting surprises that no, now there is a business shift. So additional features to be included on priority, and we need to work on it. The developed version, we need to deploy, but we need the additional features also on priority. Over here, this Agile will help. So the way we are baselining the BRS again and again, and it takes time, rather than we keep on adding the features in the product backlog. Whenever you are getting information from anyone, whether it is from the ground team, any other stakeholder, so you just need to update the Excel. This is the responsibility of the BA as a product owner. You keep on improving or increasing the that particular product backlog, Excel-based product backlog. And what will happen that we will define deliverables or releases every 1 month. After every 4 weeks, we will give a demo for the completed functionalities that, okay, this functionality is completed. We can deploy this in the production environment. And simultaneously, we will take next set of prioritized requirements from that product backlog. So in this way, it would be a continuous exercise till we are getting a mature solution. So will it be helpful in our current scenario, or we would like to go ahead with that traditional waterfall or iterative approach? That call you need to take at the time of proceeding further. So if we need to proceed in the agile way, then we need to start practices of this product backlog maintenance and sprint implementation. Now, Akbar and Ashish can comment on your question. I hope post this.
Very nice, Swati. And, you know, we have to take baby steps, as you rightly, you know, guided the entire team, Swati, that even we picked up one project. I remember, if I recall, you know, those days when we did the Agile transformation, we pick up one project. You know, we had few people who were trained on Agile. We said, okay, let's start, you know, Agile for one project. And this is exactly what we did. You know, we started in a very simple manner. We started executing it. And you learn from our experience, right? All of us learn from our experience. So we learned, then we became a little more mature. And then, you know, with time, now everybody on the floor is working in an Agile environment. So there has to be start. So completely agree with you, Swati, that, you know, if you guys can pick up one project, you know, you can pick up a simple project, let's say, you know, let's not pick up a very, very complicated project for now, because we have never worked in an agile environment before. So pick up a simple project, start writing the requirements, you know, as a figure out who is the product owner, right? He will start writing the epics. He will start creating stories for those epics. And then, you know, he will create release planning, which is like 1 month, as Swati was saying, that, okay, we will have 1 month, maybe, or you want a sprint for 1 month. It could be possible, right? For shorter duration of sprint, you need maturity. I have organizations which go for 1 week sprint. And can anyone tell me which organization go for 1 week sprint? We all use that app on a daily basis, almost Amazon. You know, you require majority, you know, maturity to actually have a shorter sprint. So for now, start with 4 week sprint. You know, you decide that these are the requirements, which are the must have, you picked it up, team is working on it. Meanwhile, you know, once it is demoed, then you, another sprint, you pick up another set of requirements and so on. So you develop for that for some time, you gain the confidence, try to shorten the sprint duration, maybe 3 weeks, 2 weeks. Also start guiding the other teams to start working on Agile. And this way, if you ask me how much time we took, we started this Agile transition in 2014. So it took us around 3 years. So 3 years it took us to have a complete agile way of working from entire digital transformation team perspective. So it takes time, but what I've seen is now, and it's a one-time effort. So once it was done, now we are reaping benefits. Okay, so what I'll do is I will also share this spreadsheet. So Swati, I know you said combine everything, whatever I've shared. So I'll combine everything today. I'll share it with Lakshmi, including this spreadsheet. You know, start implementing Agile. Also, one thing we did was we hired people as well. You know, so as I said, we hired Scrum Master. That also really helped to achieve a next level of maturity. So think on those perspectives as well. Not immediately, but maybe next year, whenever you guys have budget, so you can think on that perspective as well. But I will definitely share, you know, these things with you. Also, we will have a quiz. I know when we did a similar batch for some other organization, they were a little fear about the quiz, and it's very common. You know, even I fear quiz. If you ask me, you know, we will give you a quiz and you have to sit for the quiz. Even I will fear that. But don't worry, it will be very simple. We are not, see, it's not a theoretical quiz. It will be very practical oriented. 50 question, I will create it today. I'll give it to Lakshmi. And she will then coordinate with Swati that how we can, you know, execute that quiz, depending upon availability, all of you. It will be a simple 1 hour quiz, 50 question. And all you need to do is get at least 50%. Correct out of that. So it will be on the patterns of ECBA, which is actually conducted by IIBA. So you will have a flavor of that as well. Okay. Anything else from anyone, please? I hope you enjoyed this entire series.
To be honest, Akbar, you are I would like to hear from you because this approach and in the current approach, are we finding any difference or we are able to, like, we can discuss later that whether it is feasible for us to go in this approach or not, whether we should, what are the advantages or disadvantages, but are we able to appreciate this difference between both these approaches of agile and traditional waterfall and iterative models?
Akbar, yeah. Sorry, yes, definitely the agile is the one which gives the more visibility to the owners or the sponsors. So yes, it is. But at the same time, the maturity level which is required to do it complete in the agile way, that is also something which is required. So there's a lot of work that we have to do if you want to move from, you know, waterfall to agile. So as you know, Mohit also mentioned that we have to take baby steps.
Correct.
So we have to take a small project or a small change in some project which is happening, and then try to implement, you know, all the methods of agile and all the steps, all the documentation that is required. So and take it. So once we do a small thing, then we can take up bigger things in the agile methodology.
That will definitely happen. See, if even though we will try to, it is a change management exercise, entire shift in the practices. So it will, even though we will take very experienced resources who are masters of this field and we will deploy them, even though it will take time, at least of 6 months. Reason being that entire organization is not used to, all the team members are not used to, and agile always demand contribution from each and every resource. It is there is a word, self-discipline, teams are needed in agile. So really it will need, and it will take time definitely, but if we are able to at least appreciate that, okay, it is an approach which is beneficial from business perspective, then we can start that shifting. That is the objective. So if we are able to get that particular point, then it is helpful for us. Yeah, Mohit, complete it from my end. You can take it ahead.
Perfect, Swati. So, I mean, even I have completed it from my end. So as I said, guys, agile, shift to agile, as Swati rightly said, is truly rewarding. People do feel concerned, you know, during the initial stage, which is absolutely obvious. Whenever there is a change, we people feel concerned about that change, whether it will work or whether it will not work. But yes, as soon as you start, you know, taking some baby steps and you start realizing the benefit, you won't believe, when we went agile first time, we actually faced resistance. right? We face resistance from developers, from testers, even from business sponsors that, you know, why we are going agile, waterfall is okay, it's working for us. But as I said, we started with a simpler project, we implemented that, we got the success. We came out as we actually, what we did was we, you know, actually document the case study around that. So once it was done, it was very realistic case study. We actually even we were pretty honest about our shortcomings as well, that where we went wrong. And then we gave that case study. We used to have this town hall, right, where we demonstrated that what we have done. In this way, we motivated more teams. And it took us time. Yes, I will be very practical. Yes, it took us time. It took a period of 3 years to achieve final level of maturity. But yes, but you have to start from somewhere. Okay, so guys, I hope you enjoyed this series, you know, this entire 5-day series that we had, 5-session series. I really loved this batch. The only feedback if I have to give was if you guys would have been little more, you know, vocal during this entire session, that would have been really great. But I could have seen the improvement. I was talking to Lakshmi over the last 2-3 sessions. I could see people are talking a little more, but they were very few. You know, I can recall Neelam asked something, Akhmar asked something. But my, you know, request to all of you is that whenever you attend such batches in future, you know, try to ask as much as you can. If you ask me when I am a student, you know, I'll ask so much just to make sure that I have got what I want, right? Because all of you are investing time, your energy. So please don't feel shy. And there are never, you know, bad questions. Sometimes you ask something and you realize that, you know, it was a very silly question, but what I believe, there are no bad or silly questions. You ask something and you get the clarification. But apart from that, thank you so much for this opportunity. You know, even I learn a lot whenever I take any batch, right? Because you get to understand different perspectives. So thank you so much once again. And best of luck for the quiz. It will be an interesting quiz. Swati and Lakshmi will plan, depending upon your comfort level and availability, that when can we execute that quiz. Thank you so much.
This quiz is a online one, yeah?
Online.
So people can take as per their convenience, or they need to take now?
No. It will be, you know, we were thinking to have it next Saturday. Okay. So it will be a Google form link.
Uh-huh.
So the questions will be there, the options will be there. All you need to do is select the right option and then
click
on the submit. But as soon as you click the final question and click the overall submit, you will get to know the result there and then.
Okay, so the link will remain active for a certain time period?
Yes, it will remain active.
Uh-huh. So please mention that we need to be careful about that time period. And yes. Apurva, you are there. We need to make sure that even people have not attended some of the session or any one of the session, but if they need to participate in this quiz so that they can understand that, okay, if something they have missed or some improvement is needed, where we are standing and how we need to improve all these things. So we need to make sure that whomsoever we have invited, they are at least attending the quiz. Okay, fine. Sounds good and fair.
Perfect.
People will get a time to recall the things.
Again. Yes, absolutely. Yeah. So they will definitely get time. And Swati, you can plan it. Like if people are happy with next Saturday, you know, we will have the quiz ready today. So today what I'll do is I'll work on the quiz. I'll pass it on to Lakshmi. She will create a Google form link from that quiz.
So that, I will connect with Lakshmi and I have provided my number to Lakshmi. But I have not your number, so you can share it and accordingly we will plan.
For sure. Absolutely. Okay.
And, please.
Somebody is asking something?
Yes, I was saying, Mohit, that the quiz what you are preparing, give us so that our readiness also happens and our study everything gets understanding also gets cleared in those type of questions.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I did not go to again go for the understanding and the rest of the part. People there must have missed like me also, many calls are coming in between. I attend those call and then again I'm back to the training, listening again. So something is missed usually.
Yeah, but don't worry, Neelam. See, as I said, if you go through the recordings, this is more than enough. You know, whatever will be asked in the quiz, we have explained in the recording. So if you please go through these 5 recordings that whatever we have.
Mohit, this is Apurva. Also, I would like to request if you can share this Excel sheet and the PPT, the presentation that you were sharing, so that we can have a better understanding.
Yeah, I saw that Excel-based summarization of that BOC which you were explaining. You have prepared it or it is a part of the BOC?
No, actually it is a proprietary material. It belongs to another institute. So that Excel we can't share.
But
what I've done is I've created a smaller version out of it, which I will share definitely, Swati. So don't worry.
If you can share some training material, that'll be great.
Absolutely. So if you ask me, everything that we have shown to you, it is from BABOK. So I will share that copy as well. I will share the smaller version of BABOK as well with you. And, don't worry. I will work with Lakshmi. I'll share the material as well. And all you need to do is go through the material, go through the recordings, and then you will be completely ready for the quiz. And it will be a simple quiz. Don't worry on that. Just similar to the line that we had after every session.
Sure. And in case of any queries there or some information is needed, then we will, any one of us, like via me and Apurva, can come back to you, Lakshmi and Mohit.
Absolutely. Okay. For sure.
It may happen that people may be getting some queries later on and they need us. So we will text you and we will just help us in getting that answer of that query and
absolutely Swati.
Okay. Team, any further queries, please?
Nothing from my side.
Okay guys, so thank you so much and best of luck from my side, not only for the quiz but for your agile transformation journey. Do well. And as I said, we will stay connected at any point of time. You need to connect through me. Just drop an email to Swati. I think Swati is the point of contact for this batch, if I'm not wrong. And then, Swati can connect with Lakshmi and we will definitely respond back.
Thanks a lot, Mohit and Lakshmi. It was a really, I found the session very nice and informative.
Thank you.
The people are... as per business, the people are extremely occupied in exams, especially in current situation. But even though they are able to give time with this strength, I appreciate that. And because it was the content in that way designed. So it really helped. I hope all other people also liked it. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Swati. And thanks, everybody. Have a great weekend ahead. Thank you.
Thank you, Mohit. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
It was really enlightening sessions.
Thank you.
We learned a lot. We know how to basically structure our working, give process to the method that we are doing. So it was really, really good sessions.
Thanks a lot,
Swati, Neelam, Apurva also for arranging this session for us. Thanks a lot.
Great. Thank you. Thanks everybody. Have a great weekend. Thank you. You made my day with a good feedback. Thanks again.
Thanks, Mohit and Lakshmi. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Okay, happy weekend. Bye, everyone.
Happy weekend. Bye.